Good morning. Good morning and welcome here to Moulton First United Methodist Church. This All Saints Sunday, in which we celebrate and give thanks for those saints who have passed on and now live in the communion of saints with us in the presence of God. We'll have a special time of lighting a candle in remembrance of those who have died within this congregation in the last year, and also an opportunity for you to come forward and light one of the votives for other names that we would like to lift up this morning. As we begin this morning, I want to thank everyone for their participation and their help with the trunk or treat that we had here on the square yesterday. I believe we handed out over 470 bags of candy, 400 bottles of water, thanks to your donations, your help, your support. Thanks to everyone again who did that. I think there was a huge crowd, much bigger crowd, I think, than anyone really expected to come out. So thank you all for your assistance with that. I want to thank you all, of course, for your continued support of the church here and our ministries, both here and all the things that we do through our apportionments. A reminder to those who may be watching us online or listening to us on the radio, you can find links in the video description or going to our website to find out about how to continue to support us here at Moulton First. The other announcement that I have this morning is on Tuesday at 6, we will be having our Emmaus cluster meeting. Again, that'll be at 6 o'clock. This Tuesday night, we'll be doing communion. We'll have a devotion and just updates with our Emmaus community. There will not be a meal, so make note of that. Again, that's about all the announcements that I have this morning. And again, it is good to be here and be in worship with you this morning. It's a little odd for me after having been off last week, so forgive me if I forget something or stumble over something. But as we begin this morning to give thanks for being able to be here, to be in the presence of one another, and to give thanks for this All Saints Sunday, will you join me in prayer as we prepare for worship? God, we have come this morning to affirm our historic faith, to worship the God of our mothers and fathers. We have come to remember God's benefits to the living, to respond in thanksgiving to the mighty works of God in our lives. We have come this morning to affirm our trust in God of all futures. We come this morning to praise and bless your name, to give honor and glory this morning. God, send your Spirit to be with us, to guide us, and to lead us through this worship and throughout all of our days. We pray these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Good morning, church. Hey, it's great to see everybody this morning. Let's begin our worship as we sing hymn number 160, Rejoice Ye Pure in Heart, the first, third, and fifth stanzas this morning. Please stand as we sing.
Rejoice ye pure in heart, rejoice, give thanks and sing, your glorious banner wave on high, the cross of Christ your King. Rejoice, 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 give thanks and sing. And in gladness and in
as we affirm our faith with the Apostles' Creed, found in your hymnals on page 881. Let us join together with this historic affirmation. I believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended to heaven and sit at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Ghost, as it was in the beginning, is now, and ever shall be, world without end. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. You may be seated. As you're doing that, would you turn to hymn number 723, Shall We Gather at the River? All four stanzas this morning on this All Saints Day.
Pilgrimage will cease. Soon our
Good morning again. This morning, in addition, of course, to celebrating and giving thanks for our saints by celebrating All Saints Sunday, we will be celebrating communion today. So if you happen to come in and did not pick up one of our pre-filled communion cups, there'll be a time for you to do that. So the ushers will be able to distribute some of those cups to you. So don't worry about that. This morning, my scripture comes from the Gospel of Matthew and also the letter of 1 John. But first, I wanted to read Matthew chapter 5, verses 1 through 12. This is part of what we call the Sermon on the Mount. It's also, this section is something that we call the Beatitudes, in which Jesus lists off a number of people he says are blessed. And there's a little bit of irony in the listing of these people that he calls are blessed, because in most every sense, we would not think of these people as being blessed. But Jesus describes these people as being blessed, and these people about being closer to the kingdom of God for some of the things that they do and the who they are. Hear the words of our gospel that Matthew writes. Matthew writes, "When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak, and he taught them, saying, 'Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called the children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people revile you and persecute you and utter all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets." Oh, man. My apologies this morning. My electronic Bible decided to die on me. If you'll give me a few moments. "Blessed are you those who persecute you and all kinds of evil against you falsely on my account. Rejoice and be glad, for your reward in heaven is great in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you." You know, of all the holy days in the Christian year, All Saints Day is probably one of my most favorite. Probably really more so than Easter, more so than Christmas sometimes, and thinking about what it means for us as Christians. Because if we think about what Christmas is and what Easter is, All Saints really is the culmination and the combination of both Easter and Christmas. Because in All Saints, it's a Sunday in which we remember first the gift of Christmas. That gift of Christmas in which we were reminded that God loves us so much that he came to be with us, to be part of us, to teach us how much he loves us by being together with us in person. And of course, in Easter, we are reminded of the extent of God's love for us. That God continues to love us even though we might decide to reject God and even crucify Christ. In Easter, we're reminded that God loves us so much that despite those things that we have done, God doesn't just continue to love us, but in that, God promises that he will continue to love us and be with us and promise us a life with him. So All Saints is a Sunday. It's a day in which we are reminded of those things that come together and it's reinforced through what we are able to look forward to in the kingdom of God. It's a celebration that one day we will be fully in the presence of God as much as those who we remember today are fully in the presence of God. It's made possible through the love and through the reconciliation of Christ. And it's a day which should provide encouragement for us. A day of encouragement for us that one day because we have been given this promise and because we have been called children of God, that we have that promise to live in the presence of God. That we don't just have that promise and that encouragement that one day we will have that, but that encouragement, that promise, should also give us encouragement to live our lives that much more faithfully. To live our lives with that much more energy and enthusiasm, with confidence of the presence of God with us. Because we have that promise that God is with us, God has been with us, God will be with us. The other scripture this morning I wanted to share with you is from 1 John. 1 John chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. It points us to that idea. It reminds us of that eternal love that God has for us. Again, that love that should inspire us to live as saints. It's a reminder of what Jesus calls to us, that he lifts up there in the Beatitudes. John writes, he says there in chapter 3, verses 1 through 3. He says, See what love the Father has given to us, that we should be called the children of God. And that is what we are. That we are the children of God. That is the reason the world does not know us, is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him just as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. You know, the thing about All Saints for me is that every year it seems All Saints grows in importance and that much more specialness to me. As the list of the names of those saints who are no longer with us begins to grow, and that list that I carry with me from church to church over the years, I'm reminded of how special that gift was, first for me to know those people that we remember, and to know those people and to carry that list of people with me to know their stories. But also the more special it is that it's a reminder for us that we do carry their stories forward. The longer I'm in a place, the more I get to hear those stories about those people that we remember and recognize and honor. The more I hear about the gifts that they have given to others, for the things that they have built, for the lives that they have touched, for the impact that they've had on communities. That living history that we have when we lift up those names and we think about those names. You know, as I think about the list of names that we recognize today, the ones that we lift to who have died in the last year, for Clayton, for Charles, for Marilyn, for Pam and John, and so many others. I'm so grateful for them, for their impact that they had. For the impact that they had on this church, this community, and on so many and countless lives. We can take heart today as we give thanks for them, because they live on not just in the naming that we give today, in the naming that we do today, but they live on in the stories that we tell about them. Things that we experience because of what they have provided, the things that we experience and are we benefit from for the way that they have loved us up. You know, in a year that has been marked by grief, marked by countless losses, today is a reminder that the love that God has for us overcomes that grief. And reminds us that we will not be lost. Today, then, is not a day of sadness. It is a day that we acknowledge our grief, that we are sad that those people we name are no longer with us. But it is a day of gladness because it is a day in which we give thanks with confidence, knowing that these people that we name are in the presence of God. We can be happy knowing that though their journey on this life might be over, our journey will lead us to them and to be fully restored with them in God. That promise should encourage us to be living saints, not be holier-than-thou people, not be folks who won't be kind or gracious or think only for ourselves, but people who are truly saints, people who can bring God's presence into the world, just like those that we honor today. Since we have the confidence that Clayton, that Charles, that Marilyn, and Pam, and John are in that presence of God, and that promise is there for us, we can say with confidence today that we can be saints. That we should be able to have the confidence to live just as they did and to live with a confidence that God is with us. So that nothing might hold us back, so that we can truly bring about God's presence in the world. So let us give thanks this morning to all the saints. And may we be saints ourselves and inspired by those saints so that we might live for Christ in all we do. Will you join me in prayer? God, you have called us to respond to your grace, and to also take responsibility for sharing that grace. But so often, God, we fail to do either. Open our hearts, open our minds, and open our spirits to your work. Give us the courage and resolve to respond, and equip us to share that grace as extravagantly and as abundantly as you have shared with us. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. so much, Susan. This time we take the special moment to remember and give thanks for those saints that have died in the last year. I invite you to join me in prayer as we center our hearts and are reminded of the gift that God has given to us through their lives. Let us pray. God, we seek and find you in creation, in the world you have made, and the people that you have called. God, we're reminded of your vulnerable but powerful Lamb as our shepherd and guide, leading us to share the shelter of your abundant life. Let us recognize you here in the beauty of this morning and in its challenge. May the risen one, your shepherd Lamb, lead us to act for your justice and peace, so that all may drink from the springs of the waters of life and find their tears of sorrow and pain wiped away. In the name of the risen one, we pray. Amen. God's word to us is a word of forgiveness, a word of assurance, and a word of grace. We are loved and accepted because we are, and God is, and nothing can separate us from our Creator, our parent, and our sustainer. And with that confidence that nothing can separate us from God, we now name those saints and those servants who have finished their course. We give thanks that they rest from their stories and the legacies as they have entrusted to us. It's a tradition of the church and of this church, I believe, that after a name is read, and we'll do that this morning, I'll read out a name. A chime will be chimed, and a representative of that family is invited to come forward and light a candle in memory of that name. Those are the candles that are there on the altar. After those candles are lit and the chimes are rung, then you will have the opportunity to lift up additional names. And you can do that after those candles are lit by coming forward and lighting one of the votives on the altar rail. I believe Lynn and... Excuse me. We'll have some people helping this morning. The time change did not do well for me or technology today. So after those names are read and a candle is lit in their ministry, you'll have an opportunity to call out additional names. So this morning, as we give thanks for those lives and those names, and to give thanks for what God is offering, has offered to us, let us join together in thanksgiving for those saints. Let us give thanks for Clayton Sims. For Charles Glenn. For Marilyn Copeland. For John Jolly. for Pam Littrell. These are the names of the saints that we have lost in our congregation, that were members who are closely connected to our church. Of course, there are many others that we would like to recognize at this time. So at this time, you are invited to come forward. Please maintain some distancing as well. Tammy and Lynn, again, will assist you as you light one of the votives. But please come forward as you would like to light a candle in memory and honor of those names. And after that, we will have a final chime and a final prayer. You're invited to come forward to honor those saints. Let us pray. God, we give you thanks for all the saints who have ever worshiped you, whether in brush arbors or cathedrals, in weathered wooden churches or crumbling cement meeting houses where your name was lifted and adored. We give you thanks, O God, for hands lifted in praise, manicured hands, and hands stained with grease or soil, strong hands and those gnarled with age, holy hands used as wave offerings across the land. We thank you, God, for hard-working saints, whether hard-hatted or steel-booted, head ragged or aproned, blue-collared or three-piece suited. These saints left their mark on the earth for you, for us, and for our children to come. Thank you, God, for the tremendous sacrifices made by those who have gone before us. Bless the memories of your saints, God, and may we learn now how to walk wisely from their examples of faith, of dedication, of worship and love. Amen. I invite you to turn your hymnals to page 12 as we prepare to receive and celebrate Holy Communion. At this time, if there are any in the congregation who did not receive one of our pre-filled cups, if you would raise your hand at this time and let Tim know, and he will bring an additional cup to you. Is there anyone who needs a communion cup this morning? Wonderful. You know, Holy Communion is a reminder, of course, of our communion with God. But it's also a reminder of our connection to one another and to all Christians in all times and in all places. That we are connected to one another through the body of Christ. And that body reaches, again, throughout all time and throughout all places and includes that great communion of saints that we talk about and we celebrate this morning. So when we partake of the bread and of the cup, we don't do it, of course, in isolation, but we do it in union with God's people here, now, who were and who will be. And of course, that includes we commune with that great communion of saints. So if you will join with me, beginning on page 12 in your hymnals, as we join together, first hearing the invitation, and then our confession, and praying together our confession and hearing the pardon. First, hear the invitation that Christ our Lord invites to His table all who love Him, who earnestly repent of their sin and seek to live in peace with one another. Therefore, let us confess our sin before God and before one another. Let us pray. Merciful God, we confess that we have not loved you with our whole heart. We have failed to be an obedient church. We have not done your will. We have broken your law. We have rebelled against your love. We have not loved our neighbors, and we have not heard the cry of the needy. Forgive us, we pray. Free us for joyful obedience. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Hear the good news. Christ died for us while we were still yet sinners. That proves God's love for us. In the name of Jesus Christ, you are forgiven. Glory to God. Amen. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and a good and joyful thing, always and everywhere, to give thanks to you, Almighty God, Creator of heaven and earth, God of Abraham and Sarah, God of Miriam and Moses, God of Joshua and Deborah, God of Ruth and David, God of the priests and the prophets, God of Mary and Joseph, God of the apostles and the martyrs, God of our mothers and our fathers, God of our children to all generations. And so with your people on earth and all the company of heaven, we praise your name and join their unending hymn. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Hosanna in the highest. Holy are you, and blessed is your Son, Jesus Christ. By the baptism of his suffering, death, and resurrection, you gave birth to your church, delivered us from slavery to sin and death, and made with us a new covenant by water and the Spirit. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, Jesus took bread, gave thanks to you, broke it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and eat. This is my body, which is broken for you. Take it and eat it and do it in remembrance of me." Likewise, when supper was over, Jesus took the cup, blessed it, gave it to his disciples, and said, "Take and drink. This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Take it and drink it and do it in remembrance of me." And so in remembrance of these your mighty acts in Jesus Christ, we offer ourselves in praise and thanksgiving as a holy and living sacrifice in union with Christ's sacrifice for us. We proclaim the mystery of faith. Christ has died. Christ is risen. Christ will come again. Let us pray. O God, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us gathered here, and upon these gifts of bread and wine. Make them be for us the body and the blood of Christ, that we might be for the world the body of Christ redeemed by his blood. Renew our communion with all of your saints, especially those that we have named before you, including Clayton, Charles, Marilyn, Pam, and John and so many others. God, remind us that since we are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses, strengthen us to run with perseverance the race that is set before us, looking to Jesus, the pioneer and perfecter of our faith. Almighty God, your saints are one with you in the mystical body of Christ. Give us grace to follow them in all virtue and holiness until we come into those inexpressible joys which you have prepared for those who truly love you. By your Spirit, make us one with Christ, one with each other, and one in ministry to all the world, until Christ comes in final victory and we feast at his heavenly banquet. Through your Son, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit in your holy church, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty God, now and forever. And now with the confidence of the children of God, let us pray the prayer Christ taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. This is the body of Christ, broken for you, the blood of Christ, shed for you. This morning I will remind you that there are two layers to our communion cup this morning. First, there's a clear cellophane layer that covers the wafer. If you'll take that clear cellophane wrapper and take that off and take the piece of wafer this morning. As we take this wafer, we are reminded that this is part of the body of Christ, that we are part of the body of Christ. And in taking this bread and eating this bread together, we are reminded that though this bread might be broken into parts, it comes from the one body that we are part of. So let us take this bread and be reminded that this is the body of Christ, broken for you. Now I invite you to remove the foil layer this morning. As we take this juice, we are reminded of what Jesus told to his disciples, that this represents his blood, this sacrifice for us, that we are called to make that sacrifice with him. So as we drink this cup, we are reminded that this cup is a pouring out of Christ's sacrifice and love for us. The sharing in this cup is a sharing in the communion and the forgiveness of Christ. Let us take this cup and be remembered of the body and the blood of Christ. Let us pray. Loving God, we give you thanks for this holy mystery in which you have given yourself to us. We give you thanks for this small portion of physical nourishment that represents an infinite spiritual nourishment by being connected to you. Pour out your Spirit upon us. Remind us of your closeness to us. Remind us of the closeness of those saints with us this morning. And allow us to live as faithful servants and as faithful saints so that we might live and love and guide others to you. These things we pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Y'all please stand as we sing our closing hymn, 189, Fairest Lord Jesus, all four stanzas.